Get right into it. My first guest, all the way from down under. I wonder why they call it down under. Maybe she can tell me. Miss Emily, all the way from Australia, and she's going to share her healing, her law of attraction, and her manifestation journey with us. And the reason I'm doing this is to show you that when you change your inside, and vibrationally, you become a match on the inside for what you desire on the outside, because you always create, and y'all know that. Then you can really manifest and create just your wildest dream. So, Emily, welcome to the Law of Attraction Radio Network.
Thank you, Constance. Thank you for having me.
Well, Emily, why do they call it down under?
I can't say, Constance. I don't actually know. I've lived here since 2008. I don't know all the details, but I have a feeling it has something to do with the fact that we're in the southern hemisphere, but I'm not really sure.
Yeah, I knew that. I knew that part, Emily, but we're going to get right with it. Emily is from the US, but she's been living in Australia for how long?
Since 2008, so it's just been 15 years.
15 years. So you have such a remarkable story, and you came to me for coaching. I want to know why. And you've had 2 years, 2 years of sobriety, right?
That's right.
Wow.
Just coming up on 2 years.
Congratulations. I know a lot of people are listening, and I want them to hear your story. So go ahead, Emily.
Oh, I've got a few stories. So
Okay.
thank you, Constance. I mean, there's a few things already that you've said, and but how it started out is I became very interested in the law of attraction when The Secret came out. I started following a few people, but I found it difficult to find the resources that were really valuable to me. And I started listening to your podcast probably in 2012 or 2013, so a while back. And I just really felt really connected to you. And, years later on, I heard your podcast. I had recently been separated from my ex-husband. And I, saw this, it was a difficult time, but I saw it also as an opportunity for me to pursue a lot of the things that I wanted in life. So you had were promoting at the time a mastermind. I thought, this is amazing. This is such an amazing opportunity that I can work with Constance to be part of this mastermind group. It seemed like such great value and that I would get so much from it. And so I applied for that and became part of the mastermind group. And also, as I continued to listen to your podcasts, and this is kind of an aside story. So after joining the mastermind group, then obviously we worked together coaching one to one. And there are a couple of things related to that around the sobriety story. But one of the things that was really, I guess, kind of a moment for me was when I was listening to your podcast and I was catching up on older episodes and episodes that I'd missed. And I was just doing chores around the house at the time. And I've always just, have you in my ear. And one of the things I was letting the podcast play out, and I heard you talk about a story that was coming up with a woman who, and her story was around sobriety. She had been through divorce and she had changed her life. And I think she lives in the Southwest, but I can't remember her name.
Danita from Arizona.
Yeah, that could very well be her. And I knew what was coming up in the podcast, and I thought to myself, and at the time I'd had lots of periods of not drinking. I wouldn't say sobriety, but not drinking. And at that point in my life, I was drinking and I was drinking too much. And I was filled with shame around my drinking. I thought I could manage it. I thought I could stop on my own like I had in the past. And I was really struggling, but I was still in the headspace that I could figure this out, that I could manage my drinking, that I could drink like a normal person. And when I heard you talking about this episode coming up, I thought, this is a sign to me. This is a sign from God that I don't have control over this any longer. I really need to just stop, and that has to be it. Like I can't, it's no longer manageable for me. And that was a few months probably before we started working together one to one. And you told me within the first few sessions, because I was just going on around the same thing over and over again, that whole feeling of that shame. and the fact that I just was struggling again with, like, you know, managing my drinking. And you just said to me, listen, and you should just try going to AA. And you weren't, you know, pushing it. You just said, if you want to get the most out of coaching, you really need to consider this. And I thought, okay, you know, if Constance is telling me this, I've taken the coaching seriously, I'm going to go to some groups. And I complained that I had been to groups and I didn't feel connected to the people in the groups. And this was, had been many years ago. And you said to me, you just got to keep going until you find a group that's the right one for you, that's the right fit for you. And not long after that, I went to my first group, and it was on Zoom at the time because this was in 2021. Mm-hmm. And we were in lockdown, or off and on lockdown. But I went to the first group I went to. It was amazing. It was a women's group filled with so many positive stories, so much gratitude around sobriety, and so much hope for their future. And that was a really, and I just knew I'd found my people, I'd found my group, and I knew that I was on the right path.
Wow. And thank you so much for that vulnerability and honesty. And, you know, I hated to tell you, you need to go to 12 steps. You need to try it one more time. I know we got somebody listening, Emily, right now, who is in denial and feel like they can do it on their own. I said, you need to go to AA. And you're codependent. And boy, I thought you were going to throw a rock or something at me when I said you were codependent. And I said, you need to go to CODA meetings and you need to get a sponsor, because coaching plus your groups equals success. And I must say, you did that very diligently. So proud of you for that. Well, what would you say to somebody? I know some people right now who listen to me, who are in denial about drinking or using and or eating, the shame around that. What would you say to them?
It takes a leap of faith. It has to, you know, you have to believe that this is going to help you, and your life's only going to improve by participating in these programs. And that's definitely the experience I've had. Everything's only gotten better from doing a 12-step program in my case.
You know, I'm just so proud of you. So what about that doggone codependency when I say you need to go to a CODA meeting? You said, I'm not codependent. I've heard that before, Melody. So Emily, go ahead.
Well, I think the thing is, I think most people don't understand what it means to be codependent. And I think that's probably one of the most challenging things around accepting codependence. Mm-hmm. People, I hear a lot that people associate it with really being very needy, very clingy in relationships. But it couldn't be further from the case, because it can manifest in so many different ways. You can be needy, but you can also be completely avoidant of and not want to connect with people at all, and just want to isolate and completely protect yourself and your own feelings. And for me, the biggest change was really learning all of those different dimensions of codependency and how they showed up in my life. And for me, they showed up a lot as a need for approval. Mm. A need for control. People pleasing as a form of control. So to get people to like me, I would act in a certain way. To get love in a relationship, I would act in a certain way. I would do things, and I would just, and I really, you know, and I was filled with a lot of shame. I didn't have any self-love. And I think one of the things that I noticed with going into AA before going into CODA was the fact that as soon as I stopped drinking, I just moved my addiction behaviors into relationships. So mm-hmm. I just was now seeking that excitement, that things happening in my life, the ups and downs, the highs and lows through relationships. And that was something that, and you know, you go to these 12-step programs when your life becomes unmanageable because of your condition or your challenge. And my life was, when I went to CODA, my life was unmanageable. I wasn't, because of a relationship, I wasn't sleeping well. I wasn't eating properly. I was struggling at concentrating at work. I didn't have enough energy to do the things that were really important to me. And that was, to me, my life was genuinely unmanageable. And I knew that meant that I really had to take the program seriously.
Yeah. And most people go from they're like, okay, I've dealt with my sobriety, with my drinking or addiction, but then it goes over to a relationship. And I said to you, the reason I call you Melanie, because I'm thinking of Melanie Beattie, codependent no more, it's on my brain. And I said to you, Emily, you're not ready for a relationship. And boy, those words right there that I say to my clients, because I knew that you needed, more. I felt you needed more healing, but that is a decision that every person has to on their own choose and walk through their own journey.
Yeah, even allowing me to do that, it just reinforced how much I did need that, because I went into something that was very unhealthy for me. That whole idea that I could do that, I could fix someone else, and that again, that was such a strong experience for me that I just then I could really kind of go wholeheartedly into the program
Yeah,
and accept where I was at.
and what I did was just loved her unconditionally, allowed her to make her own choice. And then when she came back and said, I think you were right. Not that I was trying to be right, but I've done that how many times? Oh, I don't know, Emily, about 20 times, and knew that pathway. And I love how you just have walked through things. So what's your life like now? After our coaching, I mean, anything that I ask Emily to do to read, she's an avid researcher, really smart. And how do you feel like coaching and your sobriety and your healing, how has that impacted other areas of your life, like work, your self-esteem? You tell us.
Oh, it's impacted my life in so many ways. It's completely, I started. So, firstly, I have three young children. And so, just even my relationship with them. One of my biggest drivers to staying in the CODA program and working on codependency is to make sure that I'm the best person I can be. And also, of course, with AA, but I want to be the best person I can be in raising them. I'm not a perfect mom, as you know,
What?
from our
Okay.
sessions, but I want to be, I want to be good enough. I want to be, and I want to set, I want to be a great role model for them as well. I know a big challenge for me growing up, my father was an alcoholic, and it was a huge, and it really affected my life. And I didn't realize to what extent until I had read the Adult Children of Alcoholics book. And reading that was so illuminating. But in reading that, and this is before I got sober, but in reading that, I said to myself, I don't want to create this for my children because I know how I've suffered because of it. I don't want to repeat these same patterns. So there's my children. With work, I started to recognize a lot of codependent behaviors in work. So the need, and you have said that all corporate America is very codependent. Is that right? Is that,
Very,
am I
very.
quoting you correctly? Yeah. So, and I totally see that idea that you've got to always be seen to work, be working harder than everyone else. You need the validation. You need to be proving yourself. You need to have recognition all the time to feel worthy in your role. And there's always this fear that you're going to lose your, like, there's always that fear that you can lose your job and, having that hanging over you and have equating self-worth to what your career and your title is. And I would say as well, like some of the other big changes was just letting go of a lot of shame. I had a lot of shame, and I had a lot of shame going into my marriage. And then I had even more coming out of my marriage. And I had so much shame around who I was, a lack of self-value, so much fear around being me. So I knew that I had always wanted to change careers. I'd always wanted to do something differently. I got my coaching certificate many years before. But to make that shift, I was never able to say, this is what I'm going to do, set boundaries around what was important to me career-wise. And then after my divorce, I was so afraid to share my voice and put my voice out there that it took me so long. I felt like it took me so long to overcome that. But now looking back and seeing that journey and knowing where I'm at now, like I really, I believe that everything happens as it's supposed to. It happens in divine timing. And I feel really grateful for that in my experience, but it was a big thing to overcome for me.
I'm listening to you, Emily. And for those of you who are watching on video, I'm looking at you and I am amazed, but not surprised, because I always saw, I've told you this so many times, you've heard me, right? I said, you're going to be speaking to the world. I see you really helping women, and you're going to be on the on major global platforms. I always saw that in you. And from your place of being healed, we know it's a process. You are now a relationship. Are you a love coach or a relationship coach?
I'm a love coach. So I really focus on people. I'm a love and dating coach. So I really focus on people who are in that early relationship dating phase. For me, that's all I have to say, as you know, but love has always been a huge obsession of mine. And it's always been, you know, it's always been, I really have always particularly looked at, you know, how to attract relationships, how to attract, and now it's very much around how to attract healthy relationships, come from a place of healing, understand the patterns that can lead to unhealthy relationships. And one of the things that I have to, before I talk about that, another thing I just want to say around that, I had used manifestation to attract my marriage. And I remember in one of our mastermind groups, I said, I think I shared this, and you said, it's not around the law of attraction, it's around the law of vibration. Yeah. So what I had done was I had attracted exactly what I wanted. I had journaled it, I had visualized it, I put it out there, and I attracted that marriage that I was looking for. But my vibration was so off, and I was so insecure that I had attracted someone who made me feel insecure, but is also very insecure in himself. And that was ultimately what led to the demise of the relationship. So having had that experience, I really want to guide women who are in the process of finding love to help them build their own self-love, become aware of the patterns that are holding them back, but also successfully date and lessen their anxiety when it comes to finding love and relationships.
You know, that is so good, because really you're vibrating out who you are, and the attract. So if you ain't really who you say you are, you attract who you are, not what you desire. You've heard that. And when I saw you on, I'm like, I know that woman. When I saw you on my IG, I'm like, that's Emily from Australia. And boy, you have so much wisdom. You're a researcher. You've walked it out. You're living it. And you're just the perfect person. So we got about 7 minutes. Like, give us two dating tips for women or men who are, do you specifically, is your ideal client a woman? Are you open to male, female?
So currently I work with women.
So give us two hot dating tips that you would say.
I like
to
say they're hot dating tips, but number one, when you're in the dating, even for embarking on the whole dating process, and when you're in the dating process, the most important thing to do is to really work on, as you said, it's around that vibration. So making sure that you're doing things to build yourself up every day. Because what I see is a lot of women either are very disappointed by the dating experience. Mm-hmm. They feel it can make them feel like there's something wrong with them. They feel devalued if a date doesn't go the way they would like. Or in a lot of cases, what I hear from women, a lot of women obviously are getting ghosted. And it does make them question themselves. So the most important thing is to really keep building yourself up through the whole process. And then another thing that I realized, and you know, you would have told me this as well, but it's around really just taking that step back and not pushing for the relationship, not pushing for something to work out, even if it's not meant to. It's around letting the other recognize your own value, mm-hmm. see you as someone they want to spend time with, and make that effort. Because I found when I was pushing for things to work, they never ultimately worked out, or they didn't work out well, because I was trying to force something that wasn't meant to be.
Oh, I love that. So what is your dating? What is your website? I'm so proud of you. I tell you, I'm not at all surprised at what I'm hearing. You're so poised, so full of wisdom, and just your background of sobriety, 12 steps, AA, CODA. Wow, that's going to be a powerful toolbox that you can really share with women. So what is your website and how can people reach you?
So my website is emilykellylovecoach.com. And on Instagram, I'm at Emily Kelly Love Coach, and it's Kelly, K-E-L-L-E-Y. And I'm also just on TikTok.
Oh, yeah. I love TikTok. I love TikTok. So anything else you want to say?
No, just that I believe that everyone really needs to invest in themselves to live their best possible life. And it was such a great decision for me to work with you so much. And just in that experience, when I step back and look back at what happened, just all the kind of those divine kind of moments where things just really clicked, or something happened, which was the right thing to happen at the right time. And I'm really grateful for that, because I think all of that has led me to this point. And it's just, and I believe it's just going to take me further in my life.
Well, you know, everybody needs a coach, and we would coach early morning for you, early in the morning. And some of the sessions were not easy. Emily had to make some difficult choices, but she was consistent. I mean, if I felt like I got a download from the spirit, I just told her the truth. She was consistent, and I knew that she would find her tribe. So sometimes when I tell people to go to a support group, they like, well, I went to one and it didn't work. I'm like, go to another one. I went to two. Well, go to another one. When you find your tribe and you're at home, you will know it. And I can just say from what I know that Emily is a woman of integrity. She knows her stuff around love. I'm telling you, y'all. She has done the research, like I said, and she's so smart in that area, but she's walking it out. She's an avid reader. So she's not just giving you theory. She's really giving you who she is. She's giving you from a place of essence and being a woman who has healed and is loving herself and walking it out. I'm so proud of you. I don't know what to do.
Thanks, Constance.
So give us that website one more time.
Yes, Emily Kelly Love Coach.
Okay. And so do you have a free consult, or how does that go if people want to work with you and they go on your website?
I offer a free 30-minute coaching session.
Okay. So you guys, y'all go and visit her website. And we know she's in Australia, but you know, all of us coaches can, you know, we can maneuver. Time is nothing to us. And it's something when you get a coach that's in the vibration of who they are, that they know their stuff. They can tell you, you need to do 1, 2, 3, 4 and walk you through, you know, where you should be. And I'm just so proud of you. And you come across so eloquent and so calm. And because that's who you are, you've always been that way. But for me to see you walk it out in real time, it makes me want to cry, but I have on false eyelashes. And I'm not going to go that way. But you guys go to her website, visit her, get that complimentary 30-minute session. And Emily, I love you. And is it spring in Australia?
I love you too, Constance. And yes, it is spring.
It is spring in Australia. So have a happy spring. And please stay in contact with me. So everybody, we're going to go to these quick commercials. And then I'm going to be right back. And I'm going to Nashville, Tennessee. So stay tuned.
Thanks, Constance.